Oh, I can do this too. Do you?
Yeah.
Yep, that's me. But you're wondering how I got into this situation. So, they have unofficially announced the next standalone film. And for those of you that haven't heard the news yet, and no, I don't think this announcement will make you want to go home and rethink your life, the next standalone film in the Star Wars universe will be based on and about, but we don't know any real details yet, like when in the timeline it will take place or anything else. There still isn't even a script or a director officially, but the film will be Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Hello there.
Huh?
Yeah, you heard me right. Your ears do not deceive you. You can trust them. But as of right now, we don't know more than that, other than the director that is in early talks for the film is Stephen Daldry. And if you aren't familiar with that name, Stephen Daldry was nominated for Oscars for the films Billy Elliot and The Hours. And we all know that Ewan McGregor has in the past expressed his interest in playing Obi-Wan again. But sources for this announcement are stressing that since there isn't even a script yet, no actor is attached to the role at this point, not even McGregor. Daldry is an interesting choice as director for the film since Lucasfilm chief Kathleen Kennedy had hired younger directors like Gareth Edwards for Rogue One and Phil Lord and Chris Miller originally for Solo, and we know they were recently replaced by Ron Howard. And since we know these two standalones have required some rescuing in some way, shape, or form, the thought of them attempting to hire a vet director now for this film says to me that they are possibly reconfiguring their development processes for future standalone projects. Perhaps they've decided that the younger directors are too independent, and hiring a more experienced director is a safer choice for this particular franchise. Aside from this standalone, there's still the rumor that Lucasfilm is also considering a film focused on Yoda, and that they are still toying with the idea of a Boba Fett story. By the way, have you seen over on Instagram, Daniel Logan is actively campaigning to play Boba Fett again in live action. Remember, he played the younger version of the character in both Attack of the Clones and the animated Clone Wars. Now he's all grown up and ready to take over for Jeremy Bullock. Now, shall we get into the latest updates for The Last Jedi? So, the August 18th issue of Entertainment Weekly features several different articles on The Last Jedi. Here's a rundown of what you can expect in the magazine. First, can Rey save Luke? We've discussed this a little already. At the end of The Force Awakens, she travels to Octo to find him there. And so now what? Well, apparently she isn't greeted with open arms like Luke was with Ben Kenobi. No, instead, Luke isn't very pleased with the disturbance her presence brings to the island. But Rey will play a key role in helping Luke face his demons and rediscover the hero he once was. What's Luke been through in the last so many years to make him run and hide? He has, and why does he say it's time for the Jedi to end? The only history we have on Luke is that something went wrong with the Jedi Academy and Kylo Ren and the Knights of Ren kinda killed everyone. So what else could weigh so heavy on Luke? In the interview with Entertainment Weekly, Daisy Ridley states, "I don't think one girl who he doesn't know turning up a lightsaber is gonna make him go, oh, yeah, of course I'll get back into action." And Hamill responds with, "But does he not know her?" Is Hamill teasing that Luke is in fact Rey's father and that maybe abandoning his own child on Jakku when he knew the galaxy was in trouble is what's bothering him? Then she shows up and he's forced to confront her and explain to her why he left her alone? Or maybe he's more disturbed by the fact that he placed her there to protect her. Maybe he wanted to protect her from the Force so that she didn't have to face all the responsibilities that come with being a Jedi. But the Force called her and found her anyway and led her back to Luke. I don't know, it's all speculation right now. There are way too many Rey and Luke theories to count, but Hamill is definitely hinting in this interview that Luke has some kind of past with Rey. So on to another pair in the movie, Finn and Rose. We know that he starts out still unconscious from his life-threatening lightsaber injury and apparently still wants to bust loose from the Resistance. With some trouble, remind you of Han in A New Hope, baby? Rose is a super smart worker that blends in and sees Finn as a superstar. Pairing him up with her makes it a little harder to run off. She sees him as a good guy, a brave guy, giving her something to live up to. Not that it's any secret, but she gets him to stay and take on a mission that leads them to Canto Bight doing what? Well, we'll find out. And we finally get confirmation on those cute little third things, furry penguin porg things. Yeah, those. Apparently, Rian Johnson didn't want the Jedi to be lonely on Ahch-To and decided to give him some company. He was inspired by a trip to the island of Skellig Michael, where the final scene of The Force Awakens was filmed. He states, "If you go to Skellig at the right time of the year, it's just covered in puffins. And they're the most adorable things in the world. So when I was first scouting there, I saw these guys and was like, oh, these are part of the island. And so the porgs are in that realm." Also on the island are these fish bird-like aliens who have been there forever and taking care of the island. They are all female, and this is Johnson wanting to create a feeling of a nunnery. While they speak an alien language, Luke is still able to communicate with them. Now turning our attention to the not-so-good guys, how about Snoke? We finally get to see more than just a hologram, and he has some pretty cool protectors. We've already seen pictures and sketches of the Praetorian Guard, but who are they? They're crimson-cloaked Imperial Guards similar to the ones the Emperor had in Return of the Jedi. They were named after the real-life elite special guard who protected ancient Roman emperors and were designed to be able, more like a samurai, able to quickly step into action if they needed to. And totally dangerous looking. As for Snoke, he will be completely motion captured by Andy Serkis. And Johnson states we'll learn as much as we need to about Snoke. And that Serkis will deliver a satisfying menace when we finally get up close and personal with the First Order's ruler.
This is madness.
Now, we all took a big hit when we lost Carrie Fisher. Yet, Leia Organa will always be a light in the Star Wars galaxy, and this performance is not going to disappoint us. No matter what was thrown at the princess, she always stood strong and focused and moving forward and at the task at hand. She lost her son to the dark side, her brother has disappeared, and now the loss of Han Solo at the hand of their son. But Leia is focused, and her focus is on Poe Dameron, still looking fine as heck, who's almost a surrogate son. Plus, she sees potential in him to be a truly great leader of the Resistance. Plus, we got teased that there's a connection with Laura Dern's Admiral Holdo character when we saw the two women in the behind-the-scenes reel from D23. But what's their story? The story of The Last Jedi didn't change with losing Carrie Fisher, but Johnson says he hopes it will still be satisfying for Leia fans. She has touched everyone in some way. Now, I did want to add to this because I thought it was touching. Isaac shared his Carrie Fisher memory from filming, saying, "One of my favorite things that would happen from time to time on set would be when Carrie would sing old songs. Whenever that would happen, I would offer her my hand and we would waltz around the set. On a starship, in a rebel base, on an alien planet, and she would sing and we would dance. So surreal and beautiful to think about, not for all of her delicious wicked humor and fiery energy, she also had such a sweet grace. I miss her dearly." Moving on, we find out more about Benicio del Toro's character DJ, or maybe not. At first it was mentioned he was a villain, but now we are not so sure. He even said, "I don't know if he's a villain. People are saying that, but it's like they read a different script than I read." Entertainment Weekly has revealed that Del Toro's character is a slicer, which is a Star Wars speak for a hacker, and we've seen plenty of them in the extended universe. He's also part of whatever mission Finn and Rose are on in the wealthy gambling resort city of Canto Bight. Now, what about Rey? We've been waiting and debating for 2 years over her past. Will we finally get it? Well, it's going to be a start. It's important for her to know her past so she can move successfully into her future, a sense of belonging. Daisy Ridley states that she'll find the answers and discover it doesn't matter that much. It won't change who she is or wants to be. And it sounds like we will also learn a little about Finn's history, not too much in depth, but enough to get the ball rolling into episode 9, maybe. And finally, the last part in Entertainment Weekly's series is on the different villains. Kylo Ren is fighting the humiliation of being defeated by Rey at the end of The Force Awakens, but now he has to deal with the after effects of killing his father, which makes Rey hate him even more. He's a bad guy, but then he just killed the father figure she had been looking for. Rian Johnson has admitted to altering the scar a little bit, but dang, it definitely gives Kylo a more sinister look, which honestly he might need because we all know he's actually just kind of like a moody teenager. In The Last Jedi, we'll get to see more of the silver-armored stormtrooper Captain Phasma. We'll get to spend more time with her, but her story will be more told in the novel Phasma by Delilah S. Dawson, which will be released on September 1st, which is also Force Friday. Plus, some of her story gets told in the Marvel comic book Captain Phasma. First issue of that miniseries is out on September 6th. There's also a glimpse at Kylo's TIE silencer and the photo that I think might have broken the internet for a second or two, Chewbacca in the cockpit of the Falcon with a Porg. Now, real quick, I want to touch on a Last Jedi spoiler that came from an unlikely source, the kids' book, Star Wars Look and Find. This spoiler comes from the Star Wars News Net as they have read this book. It only contains 2 pages for The Last Jedi, but a couple things may spoil the opening scenes to the film for us. Skip ahead in the video if you don't like spoilers. Now, the pages show us the caretakers, a ton of porgs, and other inhabitants of Octo. And the excerpt reads, Starkiller Base is vanquished, but Kylo Ren has escaped. Thanks to Rey and her friends, BB-8 brought Luke Skywalker's coordinates back to the Resistance. On their behalf, Rey travels to the planet Octo, hoping to enlist Luke's help. While Rey persuades the Last Jedi to join the Resistance... Whoa, what? Yeah, that excerpt just definitely referred to Luke as the Last Jedi, which many have speculated, but I believe now it is officially spoiled for us. And the second page containing information from The Last Jedi depicts a space battle that appears to be going on simultaneously with what's happening on Octo between Rey and Luke. Note, the new A-Wing fighters and Resistance bombers, and we will also see what appears to be new black Star Destroyers. The pilot we are introduced to here is also Rose's sister, Paige, an ace pilot for the Resistance. And since Force Friday is just around the corner, September 1st, I do have a few Hasbro figure leaks from The Last Jedi that you should be on the lookout for. This comes from Instagram account Star Wars Rogue 507. The new line of action figures includes some major characters, but unfortunately does not include Luke, Leia, Holdo, or the mysterious DJ. We do see C-3PO in all gold, no longer sporting his red arm. General Hux, Rey, Finn, Kylo Ren, Rose, her sister Paige, a First Order Stormtrooper, and finally Chewbacca, and he even comes with a Porg. And while we're on the subject of toys, let's briefly talk about a couple things going on in the LEGO universe. Nicole Morley reports in the Metro UK that LEGO has recalled 120,000 kits, including Star Wars sets, because someone packaged the wrong shade of gray brick into the kits at the plant in Billund, Denmark. Being somewhat of a collector, I like to mention that if any of you have one of these messed up kits with the light gray bricks instead of the darker shade, I would be happy to take it off of your hands. But I digress. Instead of LEGO firing or even punishing the employee responsible for the great gray brick debacle of 2017, they instead invested money into better lighting and labeling systems to prevent another $1 million oversight from happening again, showing that they care about their customers and their employees. Nice move, LEGO. Oh, and hey, while we're on the subject, did you guys see the LEGO versions of the Last Jedi character photos? True to the originals and awesome to look at, the character photos of Luke, Leia, Finn, Poe, Rey, and Kylo Ren, clad in red, have been given the proper LEGO treatment recently. This doesn't seem to be an announcement of any kind for a future set of LEGO minifigs, but does give us a look at what minifigs of these characters might look like in the future. Now, since we're talking about toys and collectibles, I'm in the mood to spend some money that I don't really have. So, we're on the brink of HasCon, and Hasbro has been releasing info on its show-exclusive toys. The latest reveal includes Marvel and Star Wars. Now, a little off the Star Wars topic, but seriously, check out how cool this 6-inch Uncanny X-Force Deadpool figure is in this reveal. I mean, he even, appropriately might I add, comes with a taco. Okay, back to Star Wars. The show exclusive will be a Black Series 6-inch clone Captain Rex that will debut at HasCon before it's on retail shelves later this fall. The figure boasts 28 points of articulation, 4 blasters, premium packaging, and a removable helmet. The suggested retail price for this clone Captain Rex, $24.99. HasCon takes place September 8th through the 10th, just a week after Force Friday. Which reminds me, a new Marvel Star Wars comic has been announced, and we'll see the original trilogy heroes Luke, Leia, and Han visiting Jeddah from Rogue One. Kieran Gillen and Salvador LaRocca will take over the main Marvel Star Wars title this fall with issue number 38. The trio will get to Jeddah and witness the post-apocalyptic world that remains after it was attacked by the Death Star, and picks up between A New Hope and Empire Strikes Back. The story explained by Gillen is that Luke is desperately seeking the Force and he goes to Jeddah, one of the holiest cities in the universe, to find it. The key image is Luke standing in the hole where the Death Star struck the planet. Gillen also says that he plans to explore a little of the divergence between Luke and Leia with regard to the Force, how Luke chooses to embrace the ways of the Jedi, while Leia moves more into her role as a military leader. Yes. So much yes. Good. Thanks for watching another episode of Salacious Crumbs. Don't forget to give us a thumbs up and hit that bell button so you get a notification when we post new content here on Sci-Fi For Me TV. And leave us a comment because we love to hear from you. Live video game and Dungeons & Dragons over on your Twitch channel. And you can find more sci-fi news, reviews, interviews, and podcasts at scififorme.com, delivering the multiverse since 2009. And we'll have more Star Wars news and rumor on the next Salacious Crumbs.